Good morning, one and all physics students, to another episode of Physics. It's Mr. Finn again, coming to you from my house in lovely Northville. Couple of things, guys. We obviously have the end of spring break, so welcome everybody back from spring break. Hope you had a great week off. Well, obviously, the over-under COVID-19 survey goes to the overs, as school has been canceled for the remainder of the year in terms of on-class or in-site learning, on-site in-class learning. What we're going to do now is we're going to just move ahead in our time frame, starting up with circuits today, and I'm going to pick you guys up to speed over the next couple weeks on that. We're still waiting for some communication from our district as to what the time frame is going to be in terms of how we're supposed to grade you guys. So I had a lot of questions on grades over the last couple weeks, and all I can say is this. We are going to grade forward on Google Classroom, and the moment that I have any kind of indication from the district about what to do with the grades in MyStar, I will then adjust those grades. But from now on, we're going to be using the grades in Google Classroom, and then I will merge those grades with MyStar when I get some indication about what the district wants to do. The other big announcement for this week, on Thursday of this week, since we are not coming back to school, we will have our Google Form slash quiz on statics or fields, or both rather, statics and fields. So electrostatics and electric fields. That's going to be occurring this Thursday. Remember, we don't have any school on Friday, so this coming Friday will be no physics video. But you will have one Thursday morning to review a little bit, statics and fields, and I'll make that available in the afternoon on Thursday. Make sure you can get it in on the Thursday afternoon. So then that will count as your assessment for statics and fields. And we'll just merge that in again when the district gives us the indication. So the question on grades and the question on where we're going from here, we're just simply going into circuits today, starting with series circuits, and we're going to move forward from this point on April 6th. Now, you guys haven't lost any time with me in physics. If you didn't get a chance to do the stuff for the last 2 weeks leading up to break, no worries. It isn't gonna hurt you at all. It's just kind of build up information that you can easily get in the subject of circuits as we speak. So I'm going to start with my circuits intro, and for that we're going to look at the rules for evaluating a series circuit. So I'm going to take you through one example of a series circuit, take you through those rules, and show you how that works today. Tomorrow we'll do some lab work on that. Okay, so we're going to need to go to the next.
Okay guys, how are we doing? We're here at our magic board. We're just going to evaluate a simple series circuit today. Now what I have is, I have a series circuit drawn with three resistors. This is my 12 volt battery supply. I just use 12 volts so I could be convenient with a voltage. R1, R2, and R3. Now the first thing you have to notice for a series circuit is that there's only one path for the current to travel. So if I draw a dotted line in brown, there's only one path for the current to travel all the way around that purple loop. There are no offshoot loops. There's no extra areas where the circuit can diverge into other places. It's just one complete loop. So if the current's going through R1, it's got to go through R2, and it's got to go through R3. This is the definition of a series circuit. Now up here we have the first part that we're going to identify, one and only one current. This means that there's only one way for the current to go in a series circuit. If you can find a place where the current can branch into two, well, you don't have a series circuit completely. You might have a combination. We'll talk about that later in the week. But the second thing we're going to recognize, after we determine that there's one and only one current, we have to add the resistors together to get the total resistance. Now remember, we used 1 ohm, 2 ohm, and 3 ohms as three different resistors. So if we simply added 1 ohm and 2 ohms and 3 ohms, we would get 6 ohms. That would be the total resistance of the circuit. So resistors add together in series to make a total resistance. Add resistors together to find R sub T. Now guys, when I use sub T, that's going to be designating total voltage, or total resistance in this case, or even total current later. Secondly, or thirdly, we're going to find current in this circuit, the Brown current in this circuit, by providing or using Ohm's law for the totals. So we have 12 volts and we have 6 total ohms. So if I take 12 volts divided by 6 ohms, I got that right here, 12 volts divided by 6 ohms, I'm going to get 2 amps. Where is it 2 amps? The answer is everywhere. It's 2 amps all the way around the brown line. So that's 2 amps no matter where you go in the circuit, because there's only one place to go. And these circuit values, they're made of wires and resistors. Current cannot build up, or charge cannot build up, rather, in the middle of a conductor. That would be a capacitor. We don't have a capacitor. So if we know that charge cannot build up in the middle of a conductor, that means the flow rate has to be one flow rate for the entire circuit. So there's no point in putting I total, because in a series circuit, there's only one current. Well, what do we do with that next? What if we wanted to measure the voltages that are resulting from those resistors? There's a special word for that, guys. We're going to call that applied voltage or a voltage drop. Applied voltages are the voltages that just apply to those resistors that we want studied. For example, resistor 1. If we wanted to know the voltage that applied to just resistor 1, it wouldn't be 12 volts. It would be a fraction of that, because the voltage has to press across the other two resistors in the circuit. The total voltage of 12 volts must go between each of those resistors, but it doesn't go evenly. It doesn't go evenly because the resistors are not even. How much goes to each? Well, this is where most students have trouble. If we take the current through the resistor, the 2 amps, and we simply multiply by the resistance of the resistor, so I'll write that right down here. The V sub R1 is I times R1, meaning 2 amps of current going through a 1 ohm resistor. Two amps times 1 ohm will give us 2 volts. I'll do that real quick.
Okay, guys, we're back. Now,
I just made a quick adjustment. I put on the board, the magic board here, the voltage drops for our circuit. So if I was to find the voltage that each resistor required, how much push was going to go across each resistor to make this charge flow, it would be different for each resistor. For R1, it would be the 2 amps of current going through it times the 1 ohm resistor value, or 2 volts. For the second resistor, V sub R2, that stands for the voltage applied across resistor 2. Well, that would be 2 amps times 2 ohms, because resistor 2 is 2 ohms. Well, that would give you 4 volts. Lastly, R3, 2 amps times 3 ohms, which is R3's value, will give you 6 volts. Now, guys, remember when our series rules up here, we said these applied voltages do add together to give you a total voltage. So if I add up, I know I can make a quick determination on whether I'm right or not. 2 volts plus 4 volts plus 6 volts is 12 volts. 12 volts is the total voltage for the circuit. And it's the sum of the voltage drops that I've measured. Now let's look at power.
Okay, guys, let's take a look at power real fast.
Now remember, we had those voltages of 2 volts, 4 volts, 6 volts for each of the resistors in the line. Well, what would the power be for each of those resistors? Remember, power is current times voltage from chapter 34 and from last week's stuff. So if I take the power sub R1, don't get confused about the terminology here, guys. P sub R1 simply stands for the power through resistor 1. P sub R1. 2 amps of current flow through it, and there's 2 volts applied to that resistor. So 2 amps times 2 volts is 4 watts. Similarly, the power across a through resistor 2, that's 2 amps times the 4 volts. So that's 8 watts. And lastly, how about the power of resistor 3? That's 2 amps times the 12 volts. I'm sorry, 6 volts to give you 12 watts. One thing, if we add up all those powers together, we're going to get 24 watts. 4 plus 8 plus 12 is 24 watts. Here's how you know you did something right. If you take the power total for the entire circuit, 2 amps times the 12 volts, where did I get 12 volts? That's what's supplying this total circuit. That's the battery supply. And we know that 2 amps goes through it because there's only one current. If I take 2 amps times the total voltage of 12 volts, I'm going to get 24 watts. So when I add my individual powers together, I get 24 watts. And when I multiply the current times the total voltage, I also get 24 watts. We know we've done this right. Okay, guys, that's just about it. Simple series circuit rules. Of course, they can get more complicated, but we're going to look at a few more examples as the week goes along. Make sure you guys get a chance to read up on this at the beginning of chapter 35. Some of the homework problems are listed on the Google Doc. Okay, guys, we'll see you tomorrow.